On the 14th of November in 2014, in Science Week as well as it happens, the Rosetta Space Probe's lander module, Philae, made the first ever soft landing on a comet by a human-made object. The probe had been launched a full decade earlier and had slung itself off the gravitational pull of Mars to intercept a comet as it arced its way through the inner solar system. It was an absolutely unbelievable feat of maths, physics and aeronautics. And the poor students of sixth class in Glornamara and Tremore had to cope the next day with a very excited teacher who kept telling them that these weird hairless primates had managed to land a washing machine on a comet, and they'd done it using sums. Science Week was always my favourite week in my teaching career, and science was my favourite subject to teach. It's a great fit for primary school children, where they haven't been indoctrinated yet out of their natural curiosity. Anyone with a four-year-old at home, as I do, knows of an almost infinite capacity to pose the question why over and over and over. And in some sense, that question why is one of the most defining features of us as the Homo sapiens. We're the thinking primate. And that's why in science lessons, and particularly during Science Week, I used to encourage my students to ask that question. Anyone can look at a cool thing, but a scientist asks why. Oh, no. We can all look at the glass, but a scientist asks why at least some of the water stayed in there. I'm glad that partially worked, and I'm glad, too, that Ken Corley wasn't here because he would have been cross with me. Really, science is human curiosity, and it's human curiosity formalised and given a message. It's unlocked so much of what's good and some of what's bad in today's modern world, and it gives us hope for a better future that we all might be able to look forward to. We need to foster that natural curiosity in our schools and across our entire society. To do that, I believe we need to invest in our teacher training. It was referenced earlier by Deputy Sherlock. I think we need to invest in teacher training at primary level. Science can be one of the subject areas where our primary teachers feel less confident in delivering, depending on what subjects they've taken themselves during their own school career. I think maybe we need to revisit as well our science curriculum at primary level to see if it's fit for purpose, to see if it really is a spiral curriculum that builds knowledge across a child's time in primary school. And although I've always had a love of physics myself, I personally believe that a curriculum based on biodiversity and the natural world might sit better with children at that age. There's been welcome progress at second level in terms of participation in STEM subjects, but we still have a challenge in recruiting suitably qualified teachers, and Deputy Sherlock referred to that. And in terms of offering some STEM subjects into smaller schools, I fully acknowledge the contribution by Deputy Gary Gannon in terms of impediments to people in terms of accessing third level and on to doctorate level. I think that's all very true to say. But science shouldn't be seen just as a school subject or a job. It's something we should all be engaging in, all of the time, as citizen scientists, be it as birders or stargazers or gardeners. All of these activities draw us into a deeper understanding of the natural world around us. Because the experiences of the last year have taught us something about science and something about its pivotal importance. We've been told to trust the science, to listen to the science. And while the pandemic has tragically claimed many lives, it could have been so much worse without modern technology and advances in vaccine technology. Sadly, we're seeing that played out across the developing world. And with that in mind, I really warmly welcome Minister Harris's announcement today that he is to develop the role of Chief Scientific Advisor to embed scientific advice, awareness and thinking at the very heart of what we do as an Oireachtas. And I wonder, in the context of COP26 this week and the publishing of the Climate Action Plan last week, how much further along in the road of tackling climate change we would be had we listened to the science, had we heeded the science on global warming 10, 20, 30 years ago. How long we ignored the science because it posed an inconvenient truth. And what would our society of today look like if we had made the far smaller changes needed then? Former Uachtaráin Mary Robinson remarked just today at COP that you can't negotiate with science, and those may be words to haunt us. But I'm hopeful, I'm a pragmatic optimist. I believe in the power of the human capacity to change the world for the better once we put that job of work in front of us. I don't know if you've ever come across the infinite monkey theory. It's the idea that if you put a monkey in front of a typewriter for an infinite amount of time, it will eventually type the complete works of Shakespeare. But actually, the universe has already run that experiment. That primate was called Will Shakespeare. We are the outcome. We are the product of that experiment being run by the universe. We're the only thing in the known universe that asks the question why, that tries to unravel the ways and workings of the wider world around us. In some sense, we are the universe looking back at itself, trying to make sense of us, trying to make sense of itself. There's something very humbling and yet very, very empowering about that thought. Thank you. Go here, look.